everybody. Good morning, happy Sunday. Pastor Jess here. So glad to be worshiping with you again on this beautiful Lord's Day. We are in the middle. We've just kicked off our Choose Joy series, and Pastor Joe is going to be bringing us another word from the book of Philippians today, and I'm just excited to be with you and to be worshiping with you today. So we're going to start off with some great worship, and I would love it if you would sing along. And you know what? Maybe even take a picture, a little selfie, and post it in the video below. Let us know that you are worshiping with us this morning.
You are. Shit.
When faced with the reality of who you are, Lord, there really is no other response but to just raise our hands and to to stand just in awe and in wonder of who you are. That you who makes a way for us, who has loved us, who has given us eternity and life and hope and just this promise and this strength that comes from you, we just can't do anything else but worship and to continue to tell and to declare in worship and anywhere else that we possibly can to tell the world about you. And to declare the goodness of who you are, and to tell our friends and our neighbors and our family and people we meet on the street that there is hope and there is life and there is a future, that this darkness and this fear and this world in which we live is not the end of the story, but that there is something more and something better and something greater. In our present circumstances, they are, like your word says, just light and momentary troubles compared to the all-surpassing greatness of what is in store for us. So God, we just worship you, and we praise you, and we glorify your name, because you are worthy to receive it. We love you so much, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Pastor Jennifer here with a word of encouragement for you today. Do you see right behind me? That's a bird feeder that my husband set up during this quarantine. Those blue discs, those are squirrel preventative measures, but that's another story. It's been really fun and even funny at times to watch the birds come and feed, but let me tell you something unexpected that happened. At first, just the pigeons and the sparrows we normally see in our yard were at the feeder. But over the past few days and weeks that we've seen the birds, we've seen birds we've never seen in our neighborhood before. Bright orange ones, blue ones, black and white striped ones, woodpeckers, orioles and towhees. It's just been amazing to see the difference. We went from one day, oh look, there's a gray one, or there's another brown one, to, oh wow, there is a orange hooded oriole, and our little towhee is back, and there's that red shouldered hawk. It's just been really exciting. I don't know where they've been feeding all this time, but we changed something in our yard and they adapted, and now they're coming here and they're getting fed. It made me think about our times right now. Things are different. We don't go to church, but we're still the church. We may be stressed and stretched, and we may be pressed and even challenged, but God. Things are different, but God. God is still taking care of us. Our budgets are different, but God is still providing. Our church looks different, but God's still moving. This morning, I'd like to encourage you to prayerfully consider giving and to think about giving for the future of La Mirada Church, the people that we care for, the mission that we have, the place that we will be returning to, and to think about the birds, just like Jesus said. Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, but God, our Heavenly Father, feeds them, right? And are you not worth more than they? Every part of the service this morning is our time to restore our soul and say, but God. We worship and it soothes our soul. We're in the Word and it feeds our soul. We take communion and it reminds our soul. And we give and it strengthens our soul as we trust God to continue to provide. And in every act of worship, we let go of our concerns for the way things are or might be, and we say, but God. This morning, when you give, consider not just texting in your giving or writing your check like usual, but really take a moment to pray and ask God to bless and to multiply your offering so that we can continue to not just go to church, but we can really be the church together. You can give online at lamiradachurch.com/give or just text 84321 with an amount and then you'll be walked through the simple steps. God bless you all as you cheerfully and faithfully and with hope give today, remembering that in all we're going through, God.
Hello, church. This morning, we continue our Choose Joy series through the book of Philippians. Last week, I mentioned joy is happiness despite all external circumstances. And few people were more joyful amid terrible circumstances than the Apostle Paul. You see, he was in prison for spreading the gospel, literally in chains 24/7. When he wrote Philippians and still managed to use the words joy and rejoice 13 times in just 104 verses. Last week, we looked at how Paul chose to have joy in his community, the Philippian church. And this week, we're going to look at how he chose joy in the greater good. Ask any youth pastor and they'll tell you, one of the most effective ways to spread the gospel among youth is at camp. God works wonders at camp. The gospel just moves so powerfully there. So at my first full-time ministry job, fresh out of college as the junior high youth pastor at a large church, I felt that I had a lot to prove to the church leadership who trusted such a large youth ministry to a young, inexperienced person like me. I felt a great way to prove myself to do that was to put on an awesome, gospel-filled winter camp weekend for our students. And guys, I pulled all the stops. We were expecting 35 junior hires to attend, so I rented an 8-bedroom mansion cabin in Big Bear. It had a giant living room that comfortably fit everyone for all the worship gatherings. It had several game rooms with big screen TVs and video games and pool tables and a 2-acre backyard, perfect for snowball fights and sledding, and most important of all, the gospel was going to be preached powerfully because yours truly was going to be the speaker. The kids were going to hear the gospel from me, and then they were going to be saved, and leadership was going to know they picked the right guy for the job. But then, of course, because it's one of my stories, things didn't go as planned. Kind of like Paul. But thank God, Paul finds joy in the greater good. Philippians 1, verse 12. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. So what has happened to Paul? As already mentioned, he was in prison for spreading the gospel. Now, was prison a part of Paul's original plan? Remember from last week, the church in Philippi was the first church in all of Europe that Paul planted. Europe was a blank evangelical canvas, and Paul was the greatest missionary artist. Sitting in jail, part of him must have been longing to get out, be free, and continue to spread the gospel in uncharted territory. So, Paul could have easily used this opportunity to evoke sympathy from his readers, saying, oh, I'm in jail, oh, I'm not fulfilling my original plan, and oh, pity me. But he didn't. He doesn't do that. Paul says in verse 12, as we just read, that being in chains 24/7, instead of freely evangelizing all over Europe as he originally intended, has actually advanced the gospel. And he's able to say that because he's chosen to have joy in the greater good, which he specifically describes next in Philippians 1:13. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. Isn't that incredible? You see, the Romans put Paul in jail in an effort to slow him down. But little did they know that all they did was give Paul a captive audience. The guards had to be there guarding the prison, and so Paul made sure every single one of them heard the gospel. Instead of playing the victim, Paul chose joy and the greater good by spreading the gospel in a place that otherwise would have never heard it. But then what about Europe? It was a brand new frontier for the gospel, a blank slate. So if the world's most effective missionary was allowed by God to be thrown into prison, then what about all those people out there? God's got it taken care of. Philippians 1:14. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Do you guys see what God did here? Do you guys see the greater good being played out? Paul's imprisonment inspired those who were imprisoned by fear. Paul had such joy in the midst of such a trial, and that motivated otherwise apprehensive Christians, giving them the confidence and boldness they needed to evangelize in Paul's absence. Through the greater good, it's now not just new churches popping up all over Europe, it's also otherwise unevangelized Roman guards hearing the gospel. That's the greater good at work. Things were going perfectly at winter camp. There was a ton of powdery snow to play in. No one can believe how big and awesome this mansion cabin is. And of course, the most important part of my plan, I'm the one doing the teaching. I'm telling silly Pokemon stories. I'm sharing powerful scripture. Students are responding and resonating and striking in deep conversations and asking questions. And it's only going to get better because gospel night was quickly approaching. Where at the end of another powerful message, I give the kids a chance to accept Christ into their hearts for the very first time. This was big. But before gospel night, I had one more fun activity up my sleeve. We were going to hop back into the bus and drive to a place in town in Big Bear called Alpine Slide at Magic Mountain. It is an awesome snow tubing place with this giant hill covered in snow that you just fly down in on an inner tube. And the best part, they have this magic carpet, they call it a conveyor belt, that pulls you up with your inner tube so that you don't have to walk up this giant hill every time you slide down. So we were gonna go there and we were gonna stay for an hour and a half and then go back to the cabin for gospel night. See, now when we arrived for night tubing at 6 p.m., it was 18 degrees outside. It was so cold. But the students were having a blast. But then, disaster strikes. I was in the clubhouse drinking hot chocolate with some of the students when Matt, one of my two interns, comes running in frantically. Joe, where have you been? I've been looking everywhere for you. You've got to come to the bus right now. Hurry. And as I'm running out with him, I ask, Matt, what's wrong? And he's like, dude, Joe, it's one of the students, Jonathan. He crashed his tube at the bottom of the snow hill and in the process somehow lost his shoes. They flew off. So he got up in just his socks and started walking around in knee-deep snow looking for them. He couldn't find them and then was too embarrassed to say anything. So he kept on walking and kept on looking, and now his feet are frozen and he's shaking so bad he could barely talk. I've got a couple of leaders walking him over the bus right now. So as we're running toward the bus, we get in and we see Jonathan's already in there laying down, bundled up in several snow jackets. And guys, I'm not kidding. There are four or five thick jackets over top of him and another four or five jackets laid over his feet. But when I touched the top of the jackets, I could feel the cold coming right through it. I should have called the ambulance, but instead I got my leaders to call the students back early so that we can get back on the bus and get back to the cabin as soon as possible. And honest to goodness, on the way back, my mind and my heart and my attention were on Jonathan and getting him back to the cabin and getting him warmed up and getting him okay again. But about halfway there, and it was when I started thinking, wait, I'm the youth pastor. I'm going to need to be with him, making sure he's getting better. So who's going to preach the gospel message at gospel night? This is my ministry. This is my plan. This is my message that I wrote, that I've prepared, and now I can't share it. I quickly went from concerned youth pastor to cranky man-child who wasn't getting his way. And now I've got to get my two interns, my notes, and have them teach my message and hope I still get what I want out of the whole night. I absolutely did not put any focus on the big picture here. I was not thinking about the greater good, which is the complete opposite of Paul. Paul was in prison for spreading the gospel. And instead of throwing the world's biggest pity party, he used that opportunity to preach to the prison guards, and the joy he found motivated otherwise timid Christians to go out and continue Paul's work boldly. Paul looked past his situation and his plans to the greater good. And next, Paul talks about those Christians, those who were preaching and evangelizing all over Europe in his place. Verse 15. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of good will. All right, there's two groups of evangelists out there. One group is preaching out of the purest of motives, and the other out of envy of Paul's success so far. Now that their motives are stated, he describes them in a little more detail. Verse 16. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. The envious group had taken advantage of Paul's situation. They saw Paul's imprisonment as an opportunity to tear him down, to stir up trouble by spreading bad press, going around saying, "Your precious, perfect leader, well, he's in jail. So why don't you follow and listen to us now? We know what we're talking about." The other group was empathetic towards Paul. They see the greater good in his bogus imprisonment and simply wanted to continue his message on his behalf. So we have two groups doing the same thing out of very different motives. But the bottom line here is this: are either part of Paul's plan? I mean, think about it. Did Paul want to be in jail? Did Paul want envious preachers dragging his name through the mud? Did Paul even want empathetic preachers breaking ground on churches that he wanted to plant and grow? No, this wasn't Paul's plan. This isn't what he originally wanted. But check out what he says next in verse 18. This is awesome. But what does it matter? But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. You know what Paul's saying here? He's saying, I don't care that I'm in jail. I don't care that some are slandering my name, so long as what they're preaching is accurate. And I don't care that others are planting and growing churches that I was supposed to plant and grow. All I care about, the only important thing, is looking past all that to the greater good. And that the greater good is that the name of Christ is being preached and the gospel is being spread. And in that, I have found joy. So we get back to the cabin, and I dismiss all the students and all the leaders inside except for my interns, Matt and Kelsey. I then tell them, listen, guys, I need to be with Jonathan and not at gospel night. I got to call his parents and tell him what happened, and then I need to stay with him to make sure he warms up and does okay. So I'm going to need you guys to run gospel night and for you guys to teach the message, and I'll give you my notes. And that terrified them. That terrified them. They both were like, what? Teach the gospel message? We've had no time to prepare. We can't do this. And right before I said, I know you can't do this. This was not part of my plan. I bit my tongue. And I said, I believe in you. It doesn't matter who's up there. Just preach the gospel. And guys, that's exactly what happened. Later that night, after Jonathan thankfully recovered, a couple of leaders came up to me and told me how gospel night went. Kelsey and Matt team taught the gospel message, and it was powerful, and it was theirs. They didn't even need to use my notes. Then everyone prayed for Jonathan as a group. Shy students that I've never heard say a word out loud stood up in front of 30 plus of their peers and prayed out loud for him. And the highlight of the night, 13 students accepted Christ for the very first time. It wasn't about me. It wasn't about my camp. It wasn't about my message. The greater good was accomplished that night. The gospel was preached. The gospel was not hindered that night, and it was not hindered when Paul was in prison. Paul's imprisonment could not hinder the gospel. His specific plans being halted could not hinder the gospel, and even the wrong motives of some could not hinder the gospel, because the greater good was accomplished, and that is cause for joy. Paul didn't look at his situation and say, this is terrible, this is not my plan, this is just one giant waste of time, because the truth of the matter is, God didn't waste Paul's time while in prison. God used that time for the greater good, and it's no different today. God never wastes our time. Though we may waste our time by not seeing God's purpose, the greater good, for our lives at the moment. And the truth is, at the moment, there's a pandemic going on. We're all quarantined. People are sick, jobs have been lost, and nothing is going according to plan. This virus was not on anyone's agenda. But when we stop and look at the bigger picture, the greater good, we see people who have hit rock bottom finally turning to Jesus. We see people finding it easier than ever to attend church, tune in online and hear the gospel, many for the very first time. We see people coming together and helping others in need like we've never seen before. If we just put aside our preconceived notions and plans of how life should be going and take a look and focus on the greater good, then we can have joy in these dark times. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you. We thank you that you're in control, that no matter what, your will shall be done. Help us during these challenging times, like Paul, to look past what we believe life should be like and focus on and choose to find joy in the greater good. That is much easier said than done. So we pray for the strength and ability to do so. We love you, Lord. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Speaking of the bigger picture, speaking of the greater good, Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. He was hated by the Pharisees, abandoned by his disciples, tortured by sadistic Roman guards, and forsaken by his Father in heaven. But in doing so, he forever forgave humankind of their sin and gave us a chance to be with him forever. And today, through communion, we have a tangible way to remember the greater good of his death on the cross for our sins. So gather your elements, whatever they may be, so that we can partake in communion together. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray one more time. Dear Lord, thank you for your sacrifice on the cross for our sins. Thank you for raising from the grave, defeating sin and death, so that we can forever worship a living and powerful God. We pray you protect us and our loved ones and keep us healthy. We pray you heal any and all who are currently sick. We also pray for all first responders and government officials and anyone on the front lines of this virus, that you would protect them and grant them wisdom. We love you, Lord, and it's your name we pray. Amen. I love you, church, and I'm praying for you.
Jesus is calling.
sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he's Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. As you wait for the crown, tell the world of the treasure you found. Be blessed, friends.